outreach, the Middle East.
Mr. Chairman, could we take a five-minute break?
Dean is recognized.
Could we take a five-minute break, Mr. Chairman?
No.
The Democratic Party are not coming out and condemning mob violence and the attack on federal courts.
Mr. Barr, are you investigating Donald Trump for commuting the prison sentence of his longtime friend and political advisor, Roger Stone?
No.
Why not?
Why should I?
I would remind you, Mr. Jordan, Mr. Biggs, and Mr. Johnson, to stop violating the rules of the committee, to stop violating the safety of the members of the committee, to stop holding themselves out as not caring by refusing to wear their mask.
Is it permissible to drink the sip of coffee?
It is not permissible.
Freedom prospers when religion is vibrant and the rule of law under God is acknowledged.
You've been a bad boy, Jeffrey.
Welcome to American Family Radio's Focal Point, the home of muscular Christianity on conservative talk radio.
Muscular Christianity.
Where we relentlessly explore the intersection of truth and politics.
The trouble with our liberal friends is not that they're ignorant. It's just that they know so much that isn't so.
Now, here's your host, Brian Fisher.
Howdy, and welcome to a brand new broadcast edition of Focal Point on American Family Radio. Brian Fisher is my name, your congenial, convivial, amiable, and effervescent host.
As always.
Speaking of effervescence, Jeff and Rob in the house, three amigos riding together into history as we bring you the news of today. Just a quick heads up, a programming note. I'll be having Senator Jason Rapert from the state of Arkansas on as a guest at 1:30. He is a recovered COVID patient. He just got out of the hospital yesterday from a battle with COVID. So we're going to talk to him. He's one of my favorite lawmakers in the country. Strong proponent, defender of Ten Commandments monuments and so forth and many other issues. He's with us on all the major issues. So we'll talk to him at 1:30. So stick around for that. Also want to remind you, give you a heads up, that American Family Studios, which is a division of American Family Association, has produced a brand new documentary entitled In His Image, and it's all about delighting in God's plan for gender and sexuality. So this documentary takes on some very significant questions, uses biblical testimonies or biblical teaching, personal testimonies, scientific evidence to answer questions like, can you be gay and be a Christian? What if somebody feels like they have been trapped in the wrong body? Did God make me this way? Is it possible to change? Why not just live and let live? Why do we even be concerned about this issue? How do I reach somebody who's lost in sexual sin? All of those issues are addressed in this documentary, In His Image. If you want more information, you can get, there's a pre-show event on August 1st. It's free. You can register for this pre-show event by going to inhisimage.movie. Inhisimage.movie. And there you can register for this special preview event. All right.
That's this Saturday.
Is that August 1st?
Yeah. August 1st, this Saturday.
Yeah, so that's just this weekend. You can take advantage of that. All right. Let's turn our attention to content here. I want to mention, first of all, that you can get podcasts of the program. If you want to hear my conversation with Senator Rapert and you missed today's program, you can catch it on a podcast. Go to afr.net. Also, where you can catch a live audio stream of the program. You can also go to our Focal Point Facebook page for a live video and audio stream. And you can go to our YouTube channel, the Focal Point YouTube channel. Catch the same thing. Live audio and video feed. Don't forget our email address is focalpoint@afa.net, focalpoint@afa.net. Our opinion site is The Stand. You can find that at afa.net. I've got a brand new column up, just went up yesterday, on John MacArthur declaring Independence Day for the churches in America. I encourage you to go there and read that. Also, while you're at our website, you can pick up the Boy the Man book. You can order it from the afastore.net. That's my book on fatherhood for fathers specifically of 12-year-old boys. And also you can pick up my DVD from our Cultural Institute, When Ordinary People Stand in the Gap. Just take stories about ordinary people like you and me down through history who stood in the gap and made a huge difference. So you can get those two resources, the Boy to Man book and the DVD, at afastore.net. All right. Well, let's turn our attention to the Word of God as we begin the program today. We are in Titus 2. Want to jump right into it and get as much of this covered as we can. Always a kind of a scramble to get everything in. But in Titus chapter 2, this is one of the pastoral epistles where Paul is giving pastoral advice and counsel and direction to Timothy and to Titus, who were his surrogates. They were his representatives, Titus on the island of Crete, to look after the Church of Jesus Christ on the island nation of Crete. Now, two questions get answered in this chapter. What is a woman to do after she has raised her children to maturity? What if a woman has given herself to her family, given herself to her children, raised them to maturity, now they're out and on their own? What is she supposed to do with her life and her time and her energy? Paul addresses that. And question, do Christians and Muslims worship the same God? That question is answered in this chapter. Let's just jump right in. So Paul's got a word in Titus chapter 2 for older men, for mature men, that we are to be men who are worthy of respect, men who live such quality lives that younger men looking at this older man says, you know, I want to be like him when I reach that stage in my life. Now, because younger men need examples of godly manhood, of muscular Christianity, and in God's economy, that's the job of us old bulls, to be that example for the young bucks among us. So he says older men are to be sober-minded, they are to be dignified. In other words, guys, let's act our age. Nothing more ridiculous than an older guy trying to act like he's 30 and he's hip and dressed like he's 35 years old. That's just ridiculous. Let's be self-controlled, dignified, sound in faith, in love, and steadfastness. Then he's got a word for young men. Urge the young men, he says, to be self-controlled. And this is because young males tend to have more testosterone than brains. And their impulses need to be brought under the control of the Spirit of God. And the role of mature men is to show them and help them how to do it. You know, Martin Luther had a young associate by the name of Philip Melanchthon, a really bright guy, but he was young and impulsive and all that. And at one point, Luther said about his young associate, "Old Adam is too strong for young Philip." So our job as older men is to help the younger men become stronger than the old Adam. Now, here's the second question we talked about. What does a woman do when her primary job of raising children to maturity is completed? This is in verses 4 and 5. Older women are to teach what is good and to train the young women to love their husbands and children, working at home, being submissive to their own husbands, so that the word of God may not be reviled or blasphemed. In other words, when a young bride loves her husband, treats him with respect and honor, it makes God look good. People look at that marriage and they start saying nice things about God and nice things about the word of God. You know, because some of them are going to wind up saying, you know, these people are all about God. And if they're God, and the Word of God can produce marriages and families like that, maybe I ought to check that out. Now, we've seen that the job of teaching men and women when they are together, when you have mixed gender audiences, my understanding of Paul's teaching is that when you have mixed genders together and the Word of God is opened and taught, that teaching is to be done by men. That's the responsibility of men. I do not permit a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man. But does that mean that women are not ever to be teachers of the word? They are never to be teachers? Not at all. Absolutely not. Mature women, Paul says right here, are to teach women. Older women are to teach what is good and train the young women. So women, the older women, the more mature women, are to teach what is good and train young women to love their husbands and children. So they're intended by God. If you're a young wife who's completed the task of raising children, and you're at that age where that job is basically done, your kids are off to college, they're off on their own careers, what do you do? Paul says this, here's his challenge to you, become a mentor, become a counselor, become an encourager, become a trainer, become a life coach to a young bride and young mother. You know, a trainer, it's the word Paul uses here, that's a very personal thing. Lots of very famous athletes and celebrities have personal trainers. And so mature women are to become personal trainers, life coaches of younger wives and mothers. Take what you have learned from the Word of God, from your life experience, what you have learned about loving your husband, loving your children, and pass it along to the next generation of wives and mother. Pass on the baton of mature motherhood to the upcoming generation of wives and mothers. Nothing, ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, and women, I'm speaking to you right now, nothing is more noble than that. That is more noble than any kind of corporate career you could develop. Being a wife and raising children to adulthood, building a home for them, building a home for your husband and children, there is nothing more noble than that. Now, so Paul says to the young woman, teach younger wives how to love their husbands and children. Why would they have to be taught that? Well, it can be hard sometimes since husbands are not always lovable. I'm looking at you, Jeff. I'm looking at you, Rob. Doesn't apply to me because you can ask Debbie. I'm lovable all the time. But not all husbands are. And they need to be taught. Wives need to be taught how to love unlovable husbands. And children, we know, are also not always lovable. Present company excluded, of course. But Paul says the mature women are also to teach the younger women how to be workers at home. It used to bug Debbie when people would ask her, are you a stay-at-home mom or do you work? Like the two things are mutually exclusive. And the truth was she stayed home and she worked. She was a work-at-home mom. She was a home worker. She invested her talent, her love, her energy, her commitment, her creativity, her innovation into making a home for her family. It was a full-time job. You know, I've read a survey that indicates 71% of women who work outside the home wish they could stay home. I remember I had a family in my church, and the mom told me, she had a 16-year-old daughter, and one day her mom told her after school that she was going to quit her job and she was going to be home every day when her daughter came home from school. You know how her daughter reacted? She burst into tears. She was 16. She was in high school. They never get too old to have a stay-at-home mom. Now, Deb actually worked harder than I did, especially when the kids were young. And now she's got the privilege, and I've got a front row seat to see her in action, of coaching and mentoring and training and discipling younger wives and mothers, investing what she learned into the next generation. Nothing more rewarding than that. Recruiting her pallbearers every day. And I've told you about that talk I heard at a Promise Keepers conference where the guy said, you don't forget that you are recruiting your pallbearers every day. And he asked the question, who is going to stand by your gravesite and weep because you are gone? Well, I see Debbie every day recruiting her pallbearers by investing herself in younger wives and mothers. You can do the same thing. I'm going to have to stretch over into the next segment, so I won't be done with the teaching till we come back. But Paul says in verses 11 to 13, the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all men, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of our great God and Savior. I'll be right back and explain what that means. Stay with us, Focal Point, American Family Radio. Be right back.
This is Focal Point with Brian Fisher on American Family Radio.
Howdy, and welcome back to Focal Point on American Family Radio. Brian Fisher is my name. You are listening to Focal Point, the home of muscular Christianity on conservative talk radio. Talking in Titus 2 about Paul's counsel to mature wives and mothers who have raised your kids to adulthood, and now you're wondering, what do you do with your time? And Paul says, now it's your time to teach the younger wives and mothers, teach them what is good, train them up in what it means to be a wife and a mother. So that's your career. Be a life coach to a young wife, a young mother, or more than one if you have the opportunity to do it. Now let me just finish up the time in the Word. Titus 2, verses 11 to 13, Paul says, the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all men, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Unpack a little bit of that. Now, in military lingo, this word appearing in Greek military language usage, it referred to the sudden and unexpected appearance of the enemy with a view to forcing the issue of the battle. So just when Satan thinks he's won the war, the heavens will split And here will come the commander of the armies of the heavens with legions upon legions of battalions of warring angels to settle things once and for all. He's finally going to put everything right. We're finally going to have somebody in charge of our world, in charge of our politics, in charge of our culture, who actually knows what he is doing. And for the first time, this world is going to be run right. And the beauty of it is you and I are going to help him do it when he comes to set up his kingdom. That sound good to you? Sounds good to me. That's why Paul calls it a blessed hope. One last thought. Don't miss this. Notice how Jesus is described here, refers to the appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Notice this is a clear, absolutely unambiguous, unmistakable, irrefutable declaration of the deity of Christ. He is our God and as well as our Savior. So we worship Christ as God. Do Muslims do that? No, they do not. They find you doing that in Saudi Arabia, worshiping Christ as God, speaking of Christ as God, they'll cut your head off. So do not fall for the lie from the pit of hell that Christians and Muslims worship the same God. We do not. Our God has a son, their God does not. And if you believe that, they'll remove your head from your shoulders. Okay, I believe we've got our guest on the phone. Let me go ahead and pray for us. Our guest is a believer, so he'll be happy to pray along with us, and then we'll go right into our conversation with Senator Jason Rapert. So let's pray some of the things we've read in Titus 2 back to God. Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, I pray for myself, I pray for my family, I pray for the listening audience of Focal Point, American Family Radio. I pray for every man, woman, and child in this land. Pray for every elected official, our guest, Senator Jason Rapert. I pray for our mayors. Pray for our state legislators. Pray for our governors. Pray for our president, President Trump, and all of our legislators at the congressional level. And I pray that all of us together will speak and teach only what is in accord with sound doctrine. Help us to show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech in our conversation, so that those who oppose the truth, and Lord, we know there are many in our culture who defiantly oppose the truth, so that those who oppose the truth may be ashamed because they have nothing bad to say about us. May we use the authority you have given us to encourage and to rebuke where necessary. Keep us from being influenced or discouraged by anyone who would despise us. May we learn by your grace to say no to ungodliness and the kind of passions that the world indulges in. I pray that we will live self-controlled, upright, and God-centered lives in this present age. May we wait with eager anticipation for the glorious appearing of Jesus, our great God and Savior. I pray that you will redeem us from all wickedness and purify us that we may belong completely to you and be eager to do what is good. I pray that the older, more mature men among us will be temperate, worthy of respect, and self-controlled. May each one of us be sound in faith, sound in love, sound in endurance. I pray that our young men will be self-controlled and will set an example for other young men in everything by doing what is good. May the older, more mature women among us be reverent in the way that they live. May none of them be a slanderer or addicted to much wine. Instead, may they teach what is good and train younger women to be godly wives and mothers. May the young wives and mothers among us learn from their mentors how to love their husbands and children, how to be self-controlled and pure, how to be workers at home, how to be kind, and how to be subject to their husbands. May their lives bear such witness to your grace that no one will be able to malign the word of God because of them. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, a pleasure to welcome to our decision maker line someone who has been a guest on this program before, Senator Jason Rapert from the great state of Arkansas. Senator, welcome back to Focal Point with Brian Fisher.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Brother Brian. I appreciate you for reaching out. And as you know, I've been coming out of a little bit of a battle here, but I appreciate you reaching out because there are some things that need to be covered in this country with what's going on with this whole situation.
Well, tell us, so you were actually hospitalized with COVID. So, Senator Rapert, just briefly work through your recent history with COVID.
Well, as you know, I will say this virus, obviously coming out of China, the Wuhan virus that is spread all over the world, it's very interesting, isn't it, the different ways that it is affecting different countries and the politicization of this. And so I have taken it serious. You know, I am chair of the Arkansas Insurance and Commerce Committee for the Senate, have been since 2013. I was president of the National Council of Insurance Legislators. I've been a huge advocate for patients' rights in face of the pharmacy benefit manager issues that have been going on, Brian. And so I pay attention to health, public health issues. I pay attention to what's going on. And so from the very beginning, Brian, I urged people to be cautious because you've got to be smart about what's going on. You know, we obviously know what happened with the Spanish flu and the things that we've dealt with, so you'd be smart about it. So I urged caution, to use common sense. But very early you could see that it's very odd. It's almost like they're concealing from people in the country here what we could do to short-circuit this infection and the way it's going on in our country as compared to some of the other countries like Taiwan, which you've heard the doctor out of Texas speak very well about. They have not had nearly the kind of problems, and it's because they've been doing very early intervention and utilizing medicines that have stopped these things. And so, obviously, I've been urging people to be cautious, use their masks as they can, but not to be overwhelmed with fear, because the Satan and the devil is the father of fear, and that has been used to really hurt us on how we're dealing with this. And so I've been using caution, but unfortunately, on the 17th, I came down with fever, and I had immediately quarantined myself as soon as I felt that way, even away from my own family, and just began to try to deal with the fact that, okay, I've got fever, what's going on? I went in on the 18th, and I was swabbed for a test, for a COVID test here in my community. I did not get those results until the following Tuesday. And so I laid with fever basically up and down for about 6 days.
Oh, wow.
Fortunately, my physician, when they called back and said, you've got a negative test, and I said, well, I'm still very sick. So my local physician is a wonderful man. He's cared for me for 30 years. He brought me in, and he took x-rays and said, you've got pneumonia. You've definitely got pneumonia, so we need to begin to treat for this. If you don't feel better soon, then you may have to go in and get some more help here. So what happened is that I did not rally from that. They began to treat me for the bacterial infection of the pneumonia. But then on the 22nd, I ended up back into the emergency room here in my community, and they did what's called a rapid test. And in that rapid test, it came back that I actually was now positive, COVID-19 positive. And so they began to administer fever-breaking, medications to break the fever in me and to then begin to try to get some steroids into my body and to begin to just control the situation, stop it. And so fortunately, they broke the fever and then began the process of beginning to be treated to get better. And so I've been in the hospital. I was released yesterday, and I've been released, back here and to just rest and try to continue some medications. It's very interesting. I will just tell you that as soon as I went into the hospital, Brian, I asked them, I said, I've got friends that were in this same hospital, and I want the hydroxychloroquine, and I want to have the budesonide nebulized inhaler that you've heard people talk about getting better quicker.
Yeah.
I was amazed. They said, we won't prescribe you hydroxychloroquine.
Wow. You know, and I'll tell you, let me interrupt you, Senator Rapert. Let me just interrupt you just for a quick second, because I had the same experience with my primary care physician yesterday, who basically very reluctant to prescribe hydroxychloroquine for me, even though it has been proven to work in many, many, in hundreds and thousands of patients in clinical settings. But they have gotten their minds warped by what they read in the medical literature, and like sheep, they're blindly following these lies that they have been told about this drug. Anyway, I interrupted you. Go ahead. So they said they wouldn't prescribe it for you.
They wouldn't prescribe it for me. And look, I don't fault my local people, because they've done wonderful. But it's very interesting, because you could tell they were pained in it a little bit, because what they're being told is not to do it. Well, here's what they said. They put me on Remdesivir, which is $3,000 a bag.
Yeah.
For 5 days, they put me on this. And, of course, now, look, I'm very thankful for the treatment and the things that they've given to me. But the absolute unrealistic things that are being done out here. See, hydroxychloroquine, lupus patients, as you know, take this every day of their lives. I've led 8 teams to Ghana, West Africa, over the years, Brian. Every team I ever took, we took malaria medications. We started before we left here. We took the malaria meds while we were in Africa, and we continued those meds when we got home. And it was meant to protect us.
Yes.
And it's the same class of medications that could be stopping. And what they've done to these doctors and how they've attacked these people, because they're literally just telling you this works and it stops, I think it's very wrong. There's something very wrong with this, and I think that there's a lot of people involved in the debate that have politicized things to a point.
Yeah.
The worst thing that I think got you to reach out to me, because number one, I want to say this. I want to say thank you to literally the hundreds and thousands of people that have sent me their encouragement and their prayers. I absolutely believe that God heals and that prayer works. And they have done that. But what I was not prepared for, really, I've been through a lot politically since 2013, as you know, when I passed the heartbeat bill here. They have been after me so badly. But I could not believe that I was getting voicemails and direct messages, people wishing that I would die in this hospital while I'm fighting back here with these other people. I'm in a hospital with folks on a ventilator. I'm in the hospital praying for these people, praying for my doctors, and these people sending me messages, sir. If I were a Democrat, if I was Nancy Pelosi or Chuck Schumer, they would have national news stories calling for resignations for people for wishing death on me in this hospital.
Yes.
And it's ungodly. They sent pictures of my family, Brian, my wife and daughters, to me with the most awful things. I sent a few to your team because you can't play them on the air. They're so nasty.
Wow.
And the other thing that got me, which is very weird and odd, and it's demonic, it's a spiritual warfare, they sent me anti-Semitic comments. I won't even begin to get into it, the way they were describing it, but you're going to have those in your inbox, and I want you to listen to them, because the country is dealing with a true evil, Brian.
Yes.
And we've got to stand up to it. It's time to stop it completely.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, I certainly agree, and, you know, it just gives the lie. Senator Jason Rapert has been my guest in this segment. He's a state senator from the state of Arkansas. A strong believer with us on all the important values issues. And it just gives the lie to the falsehood out there that liberals, that people on the left side of the political spectrum, that they are the tolerant ones, that they are the compassionate ones, that they are the kind ones, that they are the gentler ones. They are not. Senator Rapert, let me pray for you very quickly as we close. Father, we commit Senator Rapert, we can commit to him, to you, his health and his family. Please protect him, restore him to health, and bless his family. Amen.
American Family Radio.
You're listening to Focal Point with Brian Fisher.
Brian Fisher.
Welcome back to Focal Point on American Family Radio. Brian Fisher is my name. Focal Point, the home of the fastest 60 minutes in American media. Buckle up. Heading down the home stretch for the checkered flag. Looking at a piece here in Newsry Week, written by Dr. Harvey Risch. I wish I had the time to go through the whole thing in detail, but he is a professor of epidemiology at the Yale School of Public Health. So this is a guy that's at the top of the food pyramid in epidemiology, and he has authored 300 peer-reviewed publications. He holds senior positions on the editorial boards of a number of leading journals. In other words, this guy's reputation is so bright that scientific journals ask him to come and sit on their editorial boards and help them decide what to publish in their magazines, in their publications. So he's a quality guy. He's at Yale University. So that tells you something about his credentials right off the bat. And his article I'm looking at here, this is in Newsweek, "The Key to Defeating COVID-19 Already Exists. We Need to Start Using It." And he's talking here about hydroxychloroquine, that the key to defeating COVID-19 is here. It already exists, and it is cheap. We need to start using it. And in this article, he goes through and explodes all of the false things that have been said about hydroxychloroquine, the cardiac arrhythmias. They are so rare. In fact, I think he got a figure in here somewhere. See if I can find that. Something like 9 in 100,000 people. Yeah, here it is. The arrhythmia excess death rates of less than 9 per 100,000 users. And even a paper in the American Journal of Medicine, published by established cardiologists, fully agrees with his assessment that HCQ does not represent a danger to heart health. Hydroxychloroquine works, it's inexpensive, and it ought to be used starting right now. That's Harvey Risch, Dr. Harvey Risch, professor of epidemiology at the Yale School of Public Health. And he said this at the end of his piece, "In the future, I believe this misbegotten episode, this whole thing where hydroxychloroquine has been demonized, starting with Dr. Fauci and working all the way through the deep state medical establishment, that this misbegotten episode regarding hydroxychloroquine will be studied by sociologists of medicine as a classic example of how extra scientific factors overrode clear-cut medical evidence." Well, the non-scientific factors, Dr. Fauci, he's invested in a lab called Moderna. Right now, they're leading the pack and coming up with this vaccine. That's a $19 billion payday. Whoever is the quickest to get a vaccine to market, they're going to make $19 billion with a B dollars off of that thing. So Dr. Fauci just looking out for himself, looking out for his buddies in Big Pharma. You know, and I mentioned the difference in cost. Senator Rapert, who was my guest, was on Remdesivir. This is a piece by Dr. Lee Vliet. She's the past director of the American Association of Pediatric Surgeons. And she says, look, for you can get a 5 to 7 day complete course with hydroxychloroquine with azithromycin plus zinc. It's taken orally. You know, Remdesivir, you have to take it in a hospital, and it's by injection. And Remdesivir costs $3,500. It costs for a full 5 to 7 course treatment of hydroxychloroquine with the Z-Pak, $25 to $30 cash. So you can see the extra scientific method. Anthony Fauci's looking at that and says, no way I can help my friends get rich if I push hydroxychloroquine. So what if it works? I've got friends, I want to grease their palms. So that this is all about. Follow the money, you always get to the core problem. So meanwhile, thousands and thousands and thousands of people are dying. Let me repeat that. Thousands and thousands and thousands of people are dying needlessly because Dr. Anthony Fauci will not authorize the use of HCQ in outpatient settings. This is all on Dr. Fauci. Their blood is on his head. Anyway, let's grab some sound bites. Let's start with clip number 8. I don't even know who this young lady is. She's probably around 20, probably around 21. And she just sums up. This is the best summary I've seen or heard about what's going on right now with all of this brouhaha, all of this blather, all of this nonsense, all of this insanity, all of this irrationality about COVID and hydroxychloroquine. This whole thing, the shutdown of our... Now, I've got two stories. Lockdowns don't work. Cites nation after nation after nation where lockdowns clearly do not work. So here's what she had to say, clip number 8.
If I say all lives matter, I'm a racist. If I stand for my flag, I have to apologize for it. I'm not allowed to go to church, but I can burn churches to the ground. I'm not allowed to open my own business, but I can go loot and destroy other people's businesses. If I wear a badge, have a gun, and I'm dressed in blue, I'm a racist pig. But if I walk around destroying my city with bricks and masks, I'm considered a peaceful protester. I'm not allowed to peacefully protest the lockdown at my capital, but I can go destroy and graffiti my capital. I'm not allowed to go to the park to play t-ball with my family, but I can destroy the park. I'm not allowed to protect our historical monuments and history, but I can go tear them down and have them lay on top of people. I'm not allowed to have an opinion on racial matters because I'm white, but if I don't have an opinion on it, I'm the reason why people are oppressed. I can go riot in the streets with the BLM, but if I go to a Trump rally, COVID-19 magically appears. Does anyone else not see the hypocrisy in all of this?
And she finished with an expletive deleted to emphasize it, point of emphasis. So that's a very outstanding summary. Now, I want to give you some highlights from the hearing yesterday with Bill Barr and the congressional Democrats. Jeff and I were talking on the break. The Democrats are not talking about this yesterday. They were hoping this would be their big gotcha moment. They were going to nail Bill Barr's hide to the wall. That was their goal. That's what they wanted to do. It did not happen. Democrats are not even talking about what happened because they just frankly embarrassed themselves. Let me give you an example. Here is clip number one. Here's Gerald Nadler. He's the chairman of the House Judiciary Committee. He is a mean little man. Here he's scolding the representatives about not wearing masks. Clip one.
I would remind Mr. Jordan, Mr. Biggs, and Mr. Johnson to stop violating the rules of the committee, to stop violating the safety of the members of the committee, to stop holding themselves out as not caring by refusing to wear their masks. Can we get the
picture? Is it permissible to drink a sip of coffee?
It is not permissible.
Is it permissible just to take a sip of my coffee? Mr. Chairman, may I please just take a sip from my own cup of coffee? It is not permissible. Sound like Sergeant Schultz. Jeff?
And if you were watching the video, you would notice that Nadler was saying that with his mask pulled down under his chin.
I know.
So definitely particles were, how do I say it? Well, anyways, yeah.
We're being distributed widely.
Yes.
You know, and when he gets pretty worked up. So, you know, you talk about the droplets. I mean, he was casting droplets all over that meeting room. All right, clip number two. And here's Attorney General Barr raising a good question at the end of this clip as the Democrats try to pin him to the wall. Let's listen.
Why do you think these autonomous zones in Democrat-led cities are dangerous to America?
They're dangerous because they are purporting to keep on the outside duly constituted authority of the government. They're also, to me, outrageous because the people who are living now under this autonomous zone haven't selected the government. They've selected the duly authorized government of the city and the state. So it's quite an outrage that people would use force to take over an area. What makes me concerned for the country is this is the first time in my memory that the leaders of one of our great two political parties, the Democratic Party, are not coming out and condemning mob violence and the attack on federal courts. Why can't we just say, you know, the violence against federal courts has to stop? Could we hear something like that?
Well, the answer from the Democrats is no. You know, they are still the party of secession. I'm going to start calling them the new Confederacy because what they've done here, what Democrats have supported here, is the takeover of federal land from the United States government. They have taken it by force and have occupied it. That's how the Civil War started. So again, I said Democrats are going to start a new Civil War. That would be their ultimate goal, at least Antifa. You don't hear any Democrats speaking out against this, out against this kind of violence. So they are the new Confederacy. Now here's clip number three. This is Representative Swalwell. He raises the question to Barr, gets his hat handed back to him.
Mr. Barr, are you investigating Donald Trump for commuting the prison sentence of his longtime friend and political advisor, Roger Stone?
No.
I love it.
Why not?
Woohoo!
Why should I?
How can you sit here and tell us, why should I investigate the President of the United States if you're not even aware of the facts concerning the President using the pardon or commutation power to swap the silence of a witness?
Because we require, a reliable predicate before we open a criminal investigation.
And I just gave to you, sir.
I don't consider it. I consider it a very Rube Goldberg theory that you have.
Well, it sounds like you're hearing this.
And by the way, if I apply this standard, there'd be a lot more people under investigation.
Be careful what you ask for, Representative Swalwell. And by the way, if you saw any of that, Gerald Nadler was just landing on Jim Jordan and Andy Biggs like a falling bus for not wearing their masks. Nobody that was grilling Attorney General Barr was wearing a mask. Not one. They all took their masks off to grill him with these pointless questions. All right, now clip number four. The only way to say this, here's Representative Nadler acting like a total jerk. Clip four.
Mr. Chairman, could we take a five-minute break?
Dean is recognized.
Could we take a five-minute break, Mr. Chairman?
No. That's a common courtesy, Dean is chairman of every witness.
I waited 45, an hour for you this morning. I haven't had lunch. I'd like to take a five-minute break.
Mr. Attorney General, we are almost finished. We can certainly take a break, but...
You're real classy. Well,
okay. Yeah. After this...
You are a real...
No, he wants a break now.
You want it now?
And you just committee, mentioned rudeness. I think we're seeing it on display. Let's let the Attorney General have a break.
this is just crazy. I mean, this is cruel and inhumane. Not to be too delicate about this, but why, if you've been sitting there for 4 hours sipping water the whole time, why would you need a five-minute break? Well, that's obvious. So you don't have an accident in front of the entire United States of America. It's just common courtesy to let the man have a bathroom break. And Gerald Nadler says, no, not going to do it. And he is, as Attorney General Barr said, a class act. Now, here is Gerald Nadler, clip five, talking to Representative Jordan and, again, acting like a total jerk. Clip five.
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Chairman, just real quick, I don't think we've ever had a hearing where the witness wasn't allowed to respond to points made, questions asked, and attacks made. Not just in this committee, but every committee I've been on. Particularly when you think about the fact we got the Attorney General of the United States here.
Gentleman does not have the time.
I don't want the time. I want the Attorney General to be able to have enough time to respond to accusations and questions asked him, and you guys not cut him off.
What you want is irrelevant.
What you want is irrelevant. That is your basic problem, Representative Jordan. You think that we're here to get information. You think that we're here to find out what's going on in our culture. We're not. We are here to tell you to sit down and shut up, and that's what we're going to do to Attorney General Bill Barr. All right, clip number six. This is Bill Barr. This is a bombshell news that broke yesterday when Bill Barr said this. Clip six.
Seven people at the Treasury Department unmasked Michael Flynn's name. Is this an issue that Mr. Durham is looking into?
I've asked another U.S. attorney to look into the issue of unmasking because of, the high number of unmaskings and some that do not readily appear to have been in the line of normal business.
Wait a minute. So I want to be clear. So there is another investigation on that issue specifically going on at the Justice Department right now?
Yes.
Wow, that's great. So Mr. Durham is looking at how the whole Trump-Russia thing started. You have another U.S. attorney. Can you give us that U.S. attorney's name, or is that something you're comfortable doing?
John Bash of Texas.
John Bash of Texas is looking specifically at the fact.
At unmasking.
38 people, 49 times, unmasked Michael Flynn's name and probably other unmaskings that took place in the final days of the Obama-Biden administration. Is that accurate?
Actually, a much longer period of time.
Even before that?
Yes.
All right, there you have it. Samantha Power unmasked 500 people. That's it for today. Bow low before God, stand tall before man, stand in the gap where God has placed you, and never forget, we're fighting a winnable war. See you tomorrow.